let's talk about funding open source projects and the kitchen sink ending. I haven't made a coffee time video in a while now, but a few people linked me an interesting talk that gave me the perfect opportunity to return to coffee time. The talk is titled The Economics of Programming Languages, and it's by Evan, the creator of the Odd Programming Language. It's a very good talk, so link in the description. The talk is about different funding models for the development of programming languages and how that has an influence on both the final product and the people working on it. I've been talking for a while now about how much business decisions end up influencing technical outcomes. And Evan brings up some good examples of that in his talk, starting from making a distinction between corporate and independent programming languages, to which we are going to return later in the video. In his taxonomy of programming languages, Evan also talks about a few different ways in which independent programming languages can fund themselves. For example, funding a language by selling consulting services has the upside of scaling up well, which means that as you get more successful, you will have more clients and so more money. But it also has the downside that more clients means more client work that you will have to do. Contrast this with another funding model, donations. With donations, people are paying you to work on the language itself. So that means that 100% of the money that you get is going to go into the development of the language. But donations too have a few strings attached.
The final one is donations. And I don't know of any examples of languages doing this. It might exist, but I don't know of it. And theoretically, it would correlate with language usage. But the downside is that your career is very strongly related to public perception. So it may be the case that your language is used by like hundreds of thousands, millions of people. But if you're not present in the minds of those people, like that's going to affect you, right?
So to unpack what he said, first, he doesn't know of any language that lives primarily off of donations. Second, donations scale up with your popularity, at least in theory. Third, being used by a lot of people doesn't necessarily mean that you will be present in their minds. And if you're not present in their minds, you will not get enough donations to be sustainable, regardless of how many GitHub stars you have. This last point is absolutely true. So why do people donate to Zig? Evan didn't know this, but the Zig Software Foundation has been paying core contributors for a while now, and the money comes mainly from donations. Like, yes, we do have a support contract with Uber, but that's not a big percentage of our income. So how does Zig manage to be present in people's minds? I think there are three main answers to this question. The first one is that we do the communication work necessary to let the world know what we're up to. Call it marketing if you want, call it DevRel, it doesn't matter. What does matter is that we give an opportunity to outsiders to get to know us, and that's an obvious prerequisite for getting people invested in what we're doing. The second point is that Zig is a hugely relevant project from a technical perspective. I was recently live on Twitch, first with Johnny Marler when messing around with OBS, then with Andrew while we completely overhauled the build pipeline of WebAssembly runtime using Zig Build. And those were very interesting experiences for me, because it felt really powerful to finally be able to dive in a C code base and bend it to my will. I've been programming for a few years, and for the majority of that time, I've considered C and C++ projects way too thorny to touch, which is irritating and limiting because the majority of the most interesting software out there is written in those languages. With the WebAssembly runtime especially, it really became clear to me that with Zig Build, you can significantly improve all the legacy C and C++ build pipelines out there to the point where you could totally make a career out of it. So the value of Zig is pretty real already, even if the language is not done yet. And that's one big reason why people care about Zig, but that's not all. There's still a third reason, one that has to do with the people behind the project and our motivations. Zig as a project is interesting because we don't align with the dominant narrative about open source, and yet we're successful enough to be sustainable, all while they're innovating an innovative product. So the Zig story is compelling to follow even past the technical benefit that users can already get today, because we have non-conventional ideas that seem to be working. And that's another aspect that makes people invested in our success. When people pay enough attention to Zig, they will see not only a programming language, but also a philosophy of how to run an open source project, how to deal with malicious actors, and how to reward prolific contributors. And more in general, they will learn how we make software you can love. Now, to be clear, donations are hard. People are not easily moved. And if you want to go independent with your own open source project, don't expect pure technical value to be enough to get people to donate. Another pitfall to avoid is thinking that people will share your perspective about your independent projects, that they will find your story relatable because you think it is. You need to be grounded in reality when making that kind of estimation. So if I had to look at some upcoming Zig projects through that lens, here's what I would say. Bun had a very compelling story about disrupting the JavaScript ecosystem by completely changing people's expectations when it comes to the performance and the developer experience of their tooling. And then positive that Jared would have become sustainable within 1 week of the first release. But Jared decided to get venture capital instead, so we'll never know for sure. Microsig is another project with huge technical value, but I don't see any big evil that they're fighting other than crappy spec sheets made by the hardware industry. In their case, I think their main narrative is the joy of making embedded development more streamlined and accessible to the rest of us, which is great. But it might be that consulting will be a better funding model for them. Mackenzie, instead, is not only available technically, but it also has an extremely compelling story to tell. The game industry is a mess. And this is including, but not limited, to what's going on with Unity. I definitely see donations as a viable path for Mackenzie. And in fact, Steven seems to already know what to do. Let's go back to Zig and let's do a quick recap. First, we're communicating with our audience. Second, the project is hugely valuable technically. Third, the Zig story is compelling also because of our open source and business management philosophy. What's interesting about the situation is that these aspects do synergize with one another. Our way of running the Zig project has brought us a treasure trove of insanely prolific contributors, which in turn has boosted the technical value of Zig and has given us more interesting things to talk about, which in turn attracts more interest, and so forth. And so what I would say about donations is that it's not always viable, but if you happen to check all the required boxes, it can be great for your project. Evan made in his talk one last point that I want to comment on. Consulting services and donations are funding models for independent programming languages. And if you remember, I mentioned earlier that there's also corporate languages. Within corporate languages, there's also another very interesting subcategory, languages run by corporate alliances, which according to Evan's definitions are languages
more like JavaScript, where there's a technical committee, TC39, where all these companies can come together and kind of negotiate how things should evolve to support the maximum user base and create the biggest marketplace and have the most commerce flowing.
These type of languages tend to be backed by 501c6 nonprofit foundations, which are also commonly known as trade organizations or corporate alliances. Now, these languages will have to worry less about money compared to independent languages, but they too have their own share of issues. And there's one point that Evan made that stuck with me in particular, design incentives. While developing your language, you will have a constant stream of feature requests, and it will be up to the people in charge whether to say yes or no to them. So what is going to be the set of incentives for corporate alliance languages?
So in the corporate alliance, maybe some company wants this wild JavaScript feature. They say, I don't like accessing the field X. I want that to have side effects. And you say, okay, but why mess with the alliance? You know, like the point of this is we're trying to take over the world. We're trying to have the biggest marketplace in the world and the most commerce going through it. So they need that for their business. Let's just add it. And if people don't like it, they cannot use it. They can put it in their style guides. They can put it in their linter. We don't care. Like what we want is the marketplace to be as big as possible.
So while the full picture is a little bit more nuanced than what I'm about to say, it does seem to me that choosing a corporate alliance model is a move that will lock you into the kitchen sink ending.
It's still my goal to not get carried away, like adding a lot of stuff. There's a lot of features that are not in Zig, and that's very intentional. And it's hard because everyone likes to propose features, and it's really easy to make fun of C++. But everyone has that one feature from C++ that they like, and they want to put it in your language. They want to put it in Zig. And if everyone had their favorite feature from C++ in Zig, it would just be C++. But I'm not going to let that happen.
One last thing before I close the video. Evan's talk also made other points about equating Google with a landlord, which I think are really interesting. So please do check it out. It's a very nice talk, for real.